With everything that's going on with Catholic ministers, mm-hmm. you see that you know, recently Michael Jackson's been brought up on charges.
Mm-hmm. The internet with the police officers and all that stuff.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yes, and so basically at this point, if they, in your indictment or in this case, they superseded the first indictment with just 4 counts.
Right.
And I mean, it was evident that they didn't have a case unless they were to get this RICO, which they've never done in the state of Georgia before.
Right.
What are some of the reasons why you feel they went for a RICO charge and things of that nature?
Well, first of all, I brought my accountant in, the Duke Law Firm from New York,
okay.
where I've been doing business for over 30 years, from the father to the son. I've never been audited. I've never had any problems with the IRS ever in my whole career. I've deposited millions and millions of dollars legally. I filed my tax. In fact, I've gotten money back. This is the first thing that they claim, which is a part of their setup. Right? Why they did this is because they saw the sex case by going to the internet again.
Uh-huh.
If they go up there, they'll see all the evidence. They go from beginning to end, they can see all the evidence. They went up there and saw that they were not going to win a sex case. And the only way that they can go for this man's money and go for the community over there and putting them is to create something called a RICO. So RICO is this new law that they created for Gotti, and they're using it in the system now to destroy all these kids. They're arresting people. They have people turning states on these. They call it 5Ks, where one inmate can lie on another inmate, and they'll take his time away. They'll send criminals into the street to work for them, and they'll point out other people, and they'll just come in, and their word alone means that that person can go to jail for 10, 20, 25, 30 years, and even life. And this is a widespread thing that you won't know what's going on in the system until you get in here and you see inmate after inmate taking 5Ks on their friends. They call it bashing each other in the head, and they squeal on each other, and the government gives them a chance to go out. The same thing they basically did in our case with a bunch of people. They went to them and said, we got charges on y'all, and if y'all don't take this 5K and start squealing on that man because we want to topple him, then we're going to lock you and your family up and take your kids, etc. So now what they did is they took one person and they tried to use her age as an excuse to establish a RICO, right? They had to get the RICO because they knew the sex charges wasn't going to stand. So then they had to go back to the original people and go back to them and get them something new to say because this wasn't in their original indictment. So they went back to those original people, they called their witnesses, and told them, this is what we need you to say. You got to say he structured money. Now, my records would show that how would I structure money for $10,000 and I've been depositing millions of dollars over the weeks. But what they did is they counted on the fact that they invaded their land and my house and stole all of my personal files and records and my bank statements so I couldn't present in court copies of my deposits. And then the ones they had fabricated, they presented to the public, one of them, by the way, which they didn't verify, had no date on it or nothing. They just put one up on the screen and they blocked me from being able to present my own. When my accountant was addressed by Mr. Maxwell Woods from the prosecutor, what he did is Maxwell Woods lied directly to him and said, suppose your client, you know him as Malachi Z. York, you know him as Chief Black Thunderbird, suppose he was using another name, would you know? And he was filing money with another name like Dwight D. York, would you know? And he said, of course I wouldn't know if he didn't tell me. And he said, see? And they used that, and they took what they call a misnomer, a fake name called Dwight D. York that I never lived under, right? They can't produce no documents of it. They put that on the top of the indictment, the new indictment, and started pushing it from there because they knew that's a mythological creature which couldn't be traced to a Social Security number, so they wouldn't be able to backtrack everything if the public went into looking for it because they'd have to go to Malachi Z. York or Malachi York to find my bank statements, my IRS statements, and that's why they keep a fake name on top of all my indictments so that nobody can trace out anything when people start, you know, inquiring, people want to know. So they use that one girl, they use her age. They come to find out in the middle of the court, in middle Georgia, right before Judge Royals, when we brought in an attorney called Solomon Ben Davis, he pointed out that there was a mistake in the indictment by the age. He said, the indictment, not the law, the indictment is wrong, so this has to be thrown out. If that happened, the rape shield law would have came into act. And that means everybody there above the age of 14 could not be used to testify. And out went their case. So what they did is they sat there in court in middle Georgia and lied and said she was underage, only for us to have her mother on the stand as one of my witnesses with her birth certificate, which the judge blocked again. But we have it. Also, the documents is coming back and showed that the girl was overage. Then they found out that their whole indictment had the wrong number in it. Through the whole trial, they had 21 and it should have been 12.
Mm.
And that threw it off because she was 14. And
right.
That means that the motion that we put in would have been approved and the said to himself, he said right to the prosecution, I'm afraid I'm going to have to go with Mr. Ben Davis. Ben, the prosecutor said, give us another day to prove that we'll get her birth certificate. Something they've had this case for 2 years, and they didn't have it. And they knew they didn't have a birth certificate for that girl. So the prosecution was lying just to buy time. They knew the judge was working with them at the time. So now, boom, we checked the dockets by the time we got to the trial, and the prosecution never addressed that motion. So the judge moved on that motion on his own and went into trial, speeding the trial up to rush through it, close the door so nobody can see it, and try to get a hoodwink and try to get you a life sentence. That was the whole game, and then go out to the organization and try to smash them. Huh. That's what the RICO was set up for. That's how it was set up, and it was based around stuff that they couldn't prove, laws that they couldn't prove. They actually said, you know, that I told one person, one of their witnesses, to structure money when I have a history of depositing money. In fact, I was engaged in buying a church and buying a new temple at the time, and we had deposited thousands and thousands of dollars in our accounts. We have more than one account. The account they didn't address is the Black Bank in Atlanta, where we have most of our accounts out. They came down to small banks in Athens, to Wachovia, and what banks that they knew was whitewashed and would work with them. They didn't want to consult the Black banks or the previous banks I've been dealing with for years before I came down here in 1993. You follow?
Yes.
That's how they set it up. And so therefore, when they found out recently in the PSI, when we got a PSI, we got it back, and we saw that they changed the dates around. They changed it from 21 to 12. That means the whole trial was being mishandled and was under bogus documents. They blocked out Solomon Ben Davis's motion. The judge took it upon himself to move on it and squash it so that they could proceed with this RICO.
Hmm.
That's how it happened. It was a big false. It was a big setup because they knew they didn't have a sex case. So they wanted to keep me because they had already locked me down for 2 years. They know there'd be a big stink about it with suits and file, because I got suits for the torture I've been going through filed against them. I got suits filed against the judge. I got suits filed against Putnam County and the sheriff and his friends. I got suits going against the prosecution, against suits and against the marshals and institutions for my medical treatment and different things. And they knew that was coming. They're not coming. They know it's already in, but they don't never put that on top of how many suits I got against them.
Right.
They don't mention all that kind of stuff. They don't put on television all the so-called victims that came forth on my behalf and said, you got me in indictment. I never told you that. And
right.
People, they got to understand. And a woman said, I never gave nobody no interview, no deal. That's not mine. So when my attorney turned around and said to the prosecution, can we see a copy of the 302 that the so-called agent in California is supposed to have gotten from this individual who's on the stand saying that it never happened? They said, well, we don't know where it's at. We think we lost it.
Right.
And they never could produce it. This was taking place in the court, but the public wasn't privileged to these type of things. Because
right.
What they did is the only press they allowed in was the same press, the exact same press that the judge said was responsible for spoiling Middle Georgia.
Right.
Which was Atlanta Constitutional Journal and Macon Telegraph, of course, Edington Messenger. That's all. Black reporters came down from Atlanta. Reporters from the Nation of Islam Final Call came. Reporters for the Moorish Temple came. Reporters for a black paper in Macon called Georgia Informer. And they all had their badges and legal passes to get in. And the judge said no. He blocked all the black press to put in, only the press that were part of what he called those responsible for spoiling Middle Georgia. Then he pulled a grand jury out of a part of Georgia he said was already spoiled by the parade by Sheriff Howard Seals calling a Mrs. Shalom down there in Brunswick and giving her a whole run on the case that she had in the newspaper in Brunswick before the trial came. So Brunswick was also spoiled. But because he put his mouth and said that's the only place you can get a trial, he knew that was the end of the trial. So this trial had ended at least 10 times, and they reawoke this trial. Even in the trial, when the prosecution had finished, they had rested, and then when a defense attorney went up there and smashed them down, what they did is open their case after the prosecution rested. The judge let them open and bring in more witnesses, who, by the way, were proven wrong in both cases. One or two letters were revealed that she was lying, but they brought in witnesses after the so-called prosecution had rested their case. This is ridiculous. This doesn't happen. But in this case, in the Malachi case, in the Yemassee Native American case, where precedence for jurisdiction is an issue here, to identify who we are, let people know we're Native Americans, our bloodline, and this is our land, that's frightening them. And then to use this in a more expanded way to go after other ministers. So they got a whole package going, and that's why it's going on like this, and on and on and on, so they can get out to people's mind, and they'll come back on television soon with some more lies, they'll put some more stuff up, they'll get some bogus people to come up and say they didn't know Wapians, and they did this, and they got arrested for this, and it keeps on saying, boy, them the Wapians are bad people, though. But they don't never mention the Yemassee Native American morals, which is registered by the state, registered in the United Nations, is registered in Geneva, is registered with the Bureau of Indian Affairs, is registered worldwide. Yemassee Native American morals is a that tribe, and I am the chief of that tribe, and it's on record. They can hide and hide and run, but it's going to eventually come to the surface. Go ahead.
Right. So a lot of testimony that did not make it into the trial was the testimony that basically corroborated the conspiracy story.
Yes.
And I know that after the trial, Eatington Messenger actually had an article that Jacob York actually did an interview with, I believe it was Rob Peaches.
Yes.
He works for Eatington Messenger now. He was fired from the Macon Telegraph.
That's correct.
And but actually, the conspiracy, it's much bigger than just Jacob York. Basically, what you're saying is he was just a pawn in the game?
Exactly.
Or?
Jacob York was a pawn. Jacob York had a store in Atlanta. Right before the trial, Jacob York's store closes and he disappears. Why didn't the prosecution bring their key witness and put him on the stand, Jacob York? Because they knew if Jacob York got on the stand, he got cross-examined, the truth would come out that he was on payroll and that it's a conspiracy. And that is bigger than Jacob York. When they say we're trying to make a conspiracy with my so-called son, no. No, it's not. It's Middle District, Georgia, and their conspiracy against all black ministers in the state of Georgia. Because once it bounces, once the precedent is set on this case, it's going to start flying across the different ministers' watch. Unless we make sure that they don't pull that off.
Right.
And that's what we're working for, and we got worldwide assistance. But the immediate clergy in Georgia better become a part of this. The immediate black politicians in Georgia better be a part of this. NAACP and all them better be a part of this. While they're trying to throw your attention on a whole bunch of little frivolous cases about a colored guy raised by a white family having sex with a little white girl, and all y'all go march out there for them, and they're making a fool out of you because he has three other charges they ain't telling you all about, you better get over here where there's a legit case where somebody is being lynched illegally, where all these lies are being told, and the case is being, you better get on a case and behind something that's strong and it's real, because in the long run, my case is being set up to set up all the black churches and all the black leadership.
Right.
Anybody can come out the framework and say 20 years ago you had sex with them, and they can't. They have no proof, no medical record, and they can use that and say, yeah, that's justified because of a new law they have.
Right.
It's what's called conspiracy that they created actually for drug dealers, and now they figured out they didn't got so many drug dealers arrested, now they want to try to use it in other ways.
Mm.
And the people in the church don't see it. This whole conspiracy thing was set up just to bust drug dealers, have them squeal on each other. They got so many people coming in jail. I bounced around so many jails. I seen so many people snitching on people. They got so many people being arrested in jails, a pack of people. So now they got to move around. Let's try to use it somewhere else. Let's go after the ministers.
Mm.
Let's go after the large black corporations. Let's go after all them big black businesses in Atlanta. They're fighting them.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? They're afraid of Atlanta because Atlanta is full of black independent businessmen. And they're like, we got to get them out of here in order for us to turn this back into the good old boy South.
Right. Yeah, that's definitely evident, especially with this case and the cases that you're seeing, that we see are coming up.
Oh, yeah, they came in.
Definitely. So, basically, after everything was brought to the forefront and the witnesses took the stand and their witnesses took the stand, it came down to jury deliberation.
Mm-hmm. So we had a hung jury. That means the case is supposed to be over right there. When it's a hung jury, that's it. This judge took it upon himself to read a small portion, right, to scare them again, and then threaten. We could tell that juror was threatened because of the way she responded. She didn't say, yes, sir, like, yes, all the white ones, yes. She said, yeah. Yeah, she had her head down. She wouldn't look up. She's the one who said, you know, this man is being set up. Y'all are going after this man, and I don't believe it, and I don't want to be a part of anything where it's going to be overturned in 3 months, like the other case, talking about the McMartin case, which is a fact similar to this case where they did it in California. They set the same program up to go after the people out there.
Mm-hmm.
So the jury, when it came to a hung jury, that was supposed to be it. But after the jury came back with a hung jury, this lawyer made up his mind. He closed the court down. He went back there. We know he did it himself because we know doggone well if they only release one out of all the charges, the only charge they found not guilty is eight, the eighth account, and that deals with Disney World. Why? Because they couldn't foreclose on Disney World because Disney World is too big. That is so obvious. And no way in the world could you tell me that those jurors were able to study all that stuff and understand what RICO laws and RICO accounts are about. Them functioning literals they had them sitting up there. No way possible. That was all part of the plot. The judge and them had it all set up like that to fool the public. But it's going to come around. We make it public.
I definitely appreciate you taking the time to. And
my pleasure to get the truth out.
That's right. That's what we need. That's what needs to be done at this point to let people know exactly what took place in the trial.
Okay.
Okay?
Yes.
radio that the attorney put into, in his closing argument, put in that it was physically impossible for these alleged acts to happen.
Yeah.
Through their testimonies and how many times they said it happened per week, per month. And one of those, in the closing arguments, he said over a 1993 to 2001, which is an 8 or 9 year period of time, you would have had to have sex 11,568
times. 11,568
times? Yes.
At my age, 50, what, 57, 56?
Right.
Go ahead. That sounds good. Ain't that much Viagra in the world.
And the alleged sex acts per year, this is for continuing for a 9 year period of time, would have been 1,446 times.
Wow.
Yeah, and 121 times per month. And he was mentioning that this is continual, like nonstop. So that's probably around 4 times a day for a 9 year period of time.
Well, that's only part of them. See, what they didn't do is think about all the witnesses that we put up for so-called victims. If they were adding in what they was claiming and how often they would have been, because the other people was making reference to them being with them, right?
Right.
So if you would add that on with it, and then add the one that deals with all the victims that didn't show up, the people they couldn't get, you know, you would have at least 10 times as much.
Right.
It would literally come out to thousands of times a day.
That's
physically
impossible.
It's a physical impossibility, and the judge recognized it because he mentioned during the trial, I realize which way you're going. I see what you're doing by asking these people how many times. And then we noticed that as we got near the end, the people started lessening the amount of times. People said, oh, 8 times a day versus, oh, twice a day, every day, oh, 4 times a day. But then as we get near the end, it's like one person got up there and said, I've been doing it for 4 years and we only had sex twice. We got that silly because they was taking them, the prostitution was taking them in the back and weren't telling them what to say.
Right.
They saw how their case was beginning to look ridiculous. Especially that a man my age, for them to claim them having sex over, coming out to about 1,000 times a week, that's physically impossible.
Right.
If it's not physically impossible, I'm quite sure all the men listening to this program would like to find out how.
And the whole point is they're not taking into consideration, on another note, of your medical illness.
Right, I suffer from angioedema.
Right.
I suffer from acute angioedema. In fact, I have passed twice and was resuscitated back to life. And I've had several seizures while incarcerated because of them not knowing what angioedema is and giving me the wrong medication over this last 2.5 years. And what it does is it reduces your testosterone level and it cuts down your sexual drive. So for 2 years before the arrest, I had was already diagnosed. With 2 years before May 8th, 2000, I was already diagnosed with, you know, hereditary angioedema.
Right.
And they called it acquired angioedema.
Right.
Right? And one third of the population of people who have that die, right? Well, of course, I've died twice, but by the grace of the Most High, my doctor was available, Dr. William Thompson, and he brought me back. And he had this all on record, this all logged.
Right.
But it brings down your sexual drive anyway. You have no interest in sex because your testosterone level drops.
Right.
That's the only way they can keep you from having flare-ups or swellings that, you know, which can result like something very similar to an allergic reaction.
Right.
You know, it goes around your heart, around your brain, could be around your eyes, or could be in your throat, any of the soft tissues.
Right.
And it affects you for life. So what I've been suffering for the last 2 years, though it appears there's no side effects, the fact that they've been giving me the wrong medication, down the line, 5 years from now or whatever, there will be a side effect to it. Damage will be made. Just that I'm being sustained by them giving you something like Benadryl that's to suppress it, but it's building up inside anyway. And so down the line, I know Dave, the doctor, explained that down the line I will have some complications because of the way I've been treated while incarcerated for the last 2.5 years.
And that's the damage, and that goes into the torture suit.
That's definitely a part of torture suit, which is in the hands of the United Nations now.
Okay.
And we're going before the floor of the United Nations within the next 3 weeks to present our case for the second time. We've done it already in Geneva. It's been accepted. It's been logged.
Right.
Under investigation is going. The people down here haven't felt the investigation yet, but it's definitely in the making. This case is not going to be shoved under the rug with just giving me a bunch of time and tossing me off to some remote prison forever.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that kind of case.
It's
already in the making to be exposed.
Okay.
So, yeah, it was impossible for me to be having sex like that. And for each witness to get up there and be put on, a victim to get up there and get put on the spot like that, after saying it never happened, now mind you that, after saying it never happened, they said, well, you said it never happened. And then you say, and so-and-so, and you can see the poor, these young folks have been broken. study it. They couldn't study it well. Some of them said they never had an education. Then they left the land and went out and got a high school diploma. They're in college now. Some of them said they didn't eat well, and you could see that they were obese when they were coming into court. You know what I'm saying? It was a big charade. And they didn't want the public to see it, and they didn't want the public to see them people sitting on that stand.
Right.
Because when they saw them up there, and then people started saying, this never happened. Mr. York never molested me. That was just messed the whole case up. All you need is one or two people saying it.
Right.
And that was it. In my case, he had over 30 saying it. Mm-hmm. And they still went on.
Right.
And added them in the PSI as if they said yes.
Right.
When it says they said no in it.
Right.
And then added points on it, try to boost up my rating so I get more time, just because they're setting a precedent, but we're not letting them have it.
Right.
We will fight them to the end.
Right.
We're fighting for our rights and for our justice as Native Americans. I'm a Native American. State of Georgia has no jurisdiction over me. I'm a Yamassee chief. They have no rights over me whatsoever. If I also let that's a big hoax there. That'll be exposed. And then we'll move on with the federal, who has no rights over me. We were here before they set up. We were colonists. We was in this country before they came. They have already proved in Brazil, scientists have dug up the notes and did the research and found that the original people in this land, North America, were not Mongoloid, but were Negroids, the Olmecs, originally. And that the Mongoloids came, later with a man called Hushen, or what they call the Z-tribe, X-I tribe. And then they mixed in with us. And then Africans were brought here through slave trade, and then they mixed in with us. So we have the Yamassee, the Creeks, the Seminole, the Shinnecock, the Cherokee. There's quite a few tribes, Iroquois, Ararat, the Caribbean, they call them Ararat, they call them Caribbeans. They moved down to Barbados, they went into Jamaica, they was in Brazil, at the Maroons, they was in Haiti. We moved all over the place. So, but this tribe here, that I'm the chief of, Georgia, is our base from here straight up to Massachusetts, was our land. For the Massachusetts Indian to the Yamassee, Native American, to Creek, or what we call Bali or Gwali, which is another word we use, Geechies, which is you find in Savannah, Augusta, you find them in Brunswick, you find them in all throughout Milledgeville, Putnam, Bowen, Jones, all in this whole area where all the mounds are, and the Washita tribe mixed in with us along the way. Mm-hmm. We are the original Yamassee, also spelled Yamassee,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's a black tribe that was here before the Africans. We're not descendants of the Africans. We were here when the Africans were brought here on three separate occasions. They brought Africans here. First they brought them from the Ivory Coast, then they went and brought them all the way from near Sudan, and then they migrated here on their own because they came with a treaty from Morocco and set up in the 17th century. Muhammad Seti I, and he made a treaty with George Washington. So you had the black Moors came over from Morocco, you had the African slaves brought from the West Coast, and then you had the Nubian slaves who were brought over in the 1600s by Prince Charles the Navigator. So you had three groups of Africans who came here with three different characteristics about the way they look, and they mixed in with us who was already here. And that's why some of us look African, and some of us still have wavy hair, some of us have long noses, some of us have thick lips. It's a change taking place.
You mentioned your tribe, and with everything that's going on with the case and the things that have been coming out in the news, what is the state of your tribe?
The tribe got so much going on. I mean, it's amazing. We got documents all over the world now. People from all over the world are becoming conscious that this is real. We did a family chart. Like I said, we had an outside genealogist who was a specialist in the family chart for my family, for me, my sister and brother, all the way back to Ben York of Lewis and Clark Expedition, and all the way back to his father, who was a Malian Moor. Right? All that's been traced. We have the Native American side of my family was here, and the ones that came in as Moors. That's why we call ourselves the Yamassee Native American Moors of the Creek Nation. But we are Yamassee Native Americans first, and some of the Moors came over here and mixed in with us. So our tribe is on the ball. The tribe got all kinds of things going on right now. They got documents out, letters circulating in the world. They're being translated to every language right now, and we definitely got a response. We got the verification of our jurisdiction status beyond a shadow of doubt that the state has no jurisdiction and never did over any of us. In this case, we're all part of that tribe legally.
Right.
Everybody's name and family is registered.